bring the meeting to order. Can I welcome everybody to this meeting of the Cabinet? Thank you for your attendance. Before I get into the meeting, we're just going to slightly reorder the business. After the kind of initial items, after item three, I'm going to take item six, which is the Council budget 2018-19, because there's a resolution that I want to move, which I think is important to move that first, because that kind of sets the context really for other business on the agenda. So we're going to go, after item three, we're going to go on to item six, the medium-term financial strategy and Council budget 2018-19, and then we'll take the other items as printed. So, is that agreed, Cabinet? Right, okay, so let's start with item one, members of code of conduct, declarations of interest. Do any Cabinet members wish to declare any interest? No? Okay, can I just give Councillor Chris Griggs his apologies before we proceed? Item two, the minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree that I sign them as a true record?
Agreed.
Okay. Takes us on then to item three, which is executive key decisions taken under delegated powers, and there's one key decision there. Can I ask Council to Cabinet to agree that? Okay, thank you. Okay, so we now move on to item six, which is the medium-term financial strategy and Council budget 2018-19. And I want to move a resolution around this, which please go over. It's quite a long resolution, but I think it's quite important that I go through it. There will be copies available in due course. So clearly, we want to make some progress on the budget for next year. I think just in terms of setting the context for the budget, I think it's important to say that the people of Wirral have placed their trust in this Labour administration to defend the services that they rely on to bring investments and jobs to the borough and protect the environment. These are key priorities as part of the Wirral plan. And they clearly play a major role in improving the lives of our residents. So to deliver these outcomes, we do need to set a budget for next year, which balances the financial realities facing local government, which I do believe is under attack from this government's austerity measures. And we need to make sure that, as far as we can, we deliver a budget that has the priorities and values that Labour stands for at its heart, and that's what we'll be doing. So over the coming weeks, we'll set a budget which protects services for rural residents, drives growth in the economy and provides jobs and training opportunities, and protects the environment so that our residents can enjoy a good quality of life. We won't be setting a full budget today. That will come in February, because there's some key pieces of information we still need to collect. However, as a progressive administration that is working all year round for our residents, we're going to be announcing today some savings, some new income targets, and some new investments that will be part of a fair and open and balanced budget. And I believe that only Labour can offer these solutions to the problems faced by Wirral. And indeed, every other local authority in this part of the country are facing these issues. And I have to say, it is, sadly, I think, a failure of this government that they continue to practice austerity in the, the teeth of all the evidence to show how badly people are suffering. But we need to come up with a budget that addresses that issue as far as we can. So the proposals that I'm going to announce today are about using the powers and resources available to the council to invest in growing the economy, attracting new employers, supporting our local businesses and creating jobs and training opportunities for people represent. And it's about investing in protecting the environment that shapes and defines the place that we proudly call home, from the towns and villages and suburbs where we live to the beaches and parks that attract many visitors across the region and further afield. And it's about investing in services that our residents rely on. So we are going to be, and this is a key theme of our budget announcements, we are going to be investing and strengthening the care we provide for children and families. We are going to be investing in offering support for elderly residents and improving the services we provide to our most vulnerable members of the community. And I believe that these investments are an expression of the faith this council has in our borough and the faith shown by voters that we in Labour will deliver their priorities. So, with this confidence in Wirral, I believe we can speak as one with our partners in the public sector and private enterprise. We've always said that this the plan that we have is not just a Wirral Council plan, it's a plan for all the key players in the public, private and voluntary sector. And I do believe it's supported by our elected representatives here and in Westminster and by our Metro Mayor, Steve Rotherham, and the Combined Authority. And as I said, sadly, the enthusiasm for investment is not shared by the government. And just to give a few facts, despite Wirral Council having been forced to implement cuts well in excess of £170 million since 2010, you know, that's a huge amount of money to lose from the budget. And sadly, the Chancellor's recent budget indicated that we are not yet at the end of austerity and attacks on local government. And we know nationally, in real terms, local government in England and Wales has seen its spending power reduced by more than £25 billion since 2010. An absolutely colossal amount. And as we know, local services, particularly in the north, have been decimated as a result, with libraries and children's centres across the UK closing at the rate of one every week. We've seen a steady reduction in the availability and quality of support for services which our most vulnerable residents need, leading to a huge increased demand for specialist social care services, an issue which is affecting Wirral as acutely as any other area of the country. Now, worse is to come, I have to report, and we all know that the main block of funding that historically relied on, the government's revenue support grant, which has for many years been the principal source of income for authorities like Wirral, will be totally and utterly withdrawn. So after nearly a decade of real-term reductions, that the government will be removing that in its entirety by 2021, demanding that local services are funded exclusively by either council tax and business rates or fees and charges, and that is a huge, huge change in the local government and finance landscape, and a fact which I think possibly not many people understand, but I think it is important to make a point that this is a sea change in local government finance, and that's why I've used the expression before, we are facing a financial cliff face because of the withdrawal of the government grants in its entirety. And I think it sends a message to Wirral residents from the government that actually you're on your own. There will be no more central government support after 2021. Now, I believe, and Cabinet believes, that this is a shameful and dangerous dereliction of duty, and we need to campaign, lobby, to get the government to change direction on this, because it will do damage, which I believe will be irreversible. So the challenge before us is stark. Just to bring it more to a local level, next year this council is facing a budget deficit, which is the gap between the income we receive and the cost of the services we offer, of £61 million. That is our biggest ever financial challenge. I've certainly been on this council a long time, and it's certainly the largest gap that we've ever had to close. So to put that in context, if you currently earn £2,000 a month, you're facing a pay cut of £300 per month. So with rising prices, demand for services growing, and plans for the future to be supported, this is a huge amount of money to be lost from the budget. And people should make no mistake, and I think we need to say this loud and clean, clearly, as we have been for some weeks now, this administration utterly opposes the government's austerity agenda and the impact that this is having on our services. But we are a responsible and we're a caring administration and under attack from a couldn't care less Tory government. And we've got to be pragmatic. We've got to set a legal budget. We know the framework that we must work within. But we've got to do that in a way that protects the people, the most vulnerable people in society and the people that we care about most. I think we need to be under no illusion. If we do not set a legal budget, the consequences are stark. Government commissioners, officials will be sent in, and these cuts will be enforced with, I believe, scant regard for local needs or the services which our residents cherish. That is the consequence of not setting a legal budget. What we won't allow is for our services to be cut to the bone simply to meet government-imposed savings targets. And I believe Wirral knows what's best for our borough and our residents, not Whitehall. And we share residents' and businesses' ambitions for Wirral. The budget we do have available must be invested in delivering what we've promised local people. Our 2020 pledges in the Wirral Plan spell out our ambitions, and we won't be diverted from delivering those pledges for the people of Wirral. As an administration, we have to innovate. We have to redraw from top to bottom how we achieve what our residents need, and we need to focus on the outcomes we want to deliver. That's why we're reviewing all our services, and at the moment we're doing a big piece of work, as people know, around leisure and culture, in partnership with the key people who care about them most, is really important, the transformation agenda. It's why we're redesigning customer services. It's why we're integrating our social care services with the NHS. It's why we're investing significant sums into children's services to once again make sure our most vulnerable young people and families are provided with the best, safest, most supportive services possible. It's why we're investing in the public realm, in making Wirral a better, more attractive place to live through major improvements to our highways, transport infrastructure and housing. So the budget we will be moving in February and the measures that I'm announcing today is, I believe, one of ambition, not passive acceptance. It's innovative, it's not more of the same, and it's about investment, not cuts. So, I do believe it's a budget that our residents will support, as it will help us deliver our promise of an improved Wirral and a brighter future for our local people. So, moving now down to the specifics around the challenge for Wirral Council. So, we know that we are being forced to reduce our spending or generate more income by around £132 million over the next 4 years. And as I say, our immediate challenge is the £61 million funding shortfall for 2018-19. And we know that this is happening at a time of increased need. We've got an ageing population, we've got significant pockets of deprivation, communities with complex needs, and rising costs of services and the support which people rely on. So a huge number of pressures on our budget, on top of the government cuts. I just want to say a few words about children's services, and Bernie, you may want to come in afterwards to say a bit more. But I think, and we mentioned this at council last week, nowhere is the impact of austerity more evident than in children's services in Wirral, but not just in Wirral, up and down the country. I think it's not underplaying the situation to say we are in the midst of a national crisis in children's social care. And that's a crisis born out of the government's, I think, cruel and failed programme of austerity. It's a crisis which the Chancellor could and should have addressed in his national budget on the 22nd of November. Unfortunately, he failed to do that. and the consequences of that are stark. So in England and Wales, we are seeing the highest numbers of children in care in history. Yet it didn't even warrant a mention in his budget speech. Just to give you some headline facts, we know there's been a huge unprecedented increase in demand in our children's social care, which has stretched services all across the UK to breaking point. So the number of looked after children in England and Wales has now reached 72,670 in the year to March 2017, its highest ever level. 90 children every day are being taken into care. Since 2010, children with a child protection plan has increased by almost 30%. And the view from all the lead professionals you speak to in children's social care is clear. This is the result of austerity policies. A combination of issues like the steady reduction of prevention services and the impact from changes and reductions to benefits and by cruel policies such as the bedroom tax. So in Wirral, we are also feeling the impact of this trend at the same level of other areas in the UK. So we know that today we have more than 830 children in our care, and that's at the highest level than we've ever had. So it's impacting locally as well. And we know that this is having huge pressures on our budget. So each child we have in our care, which as well as the appalling human cost of that, brings additional and significant financial costs. On average, every child costs in the region of £150,000 per year to look after. Some of these children need such specialist care that it costs more than £5,000 per week to keep them safe and looked after. This is one of the many, many hidden costs, both financial and human, brought about by the government's austerity programme. But, having said all of that, children's services must be properly funded. We cannot leave a child in an unsafe situation because we don't have the money available to protect them. That's morally wrong, and it also flies in the face of where we stand as the Labour Administration. It's also a breach of our legal duty. And these massive increases in demand for children's social care, I believe, must be met. So with a government who won't take its responsibility, it is left for this council to take action. And we will take that action. So we need to invest to meet the immediate rise in demand in children's services, but also to make sure we can reduce this demand in the future. So we will invest in children's services to the tune of almost £20 million for the coming financial year, and ensure that in our borough we step in where government has failed and keep children safe, protected at the top of our list of priorities. We will invest in our workforce by recruiting experienced, talented social workers. We must commit to our current workforce, making sure they're paid a competitive rate and doing all we can to retain good staff and reduce the level and cost of agency workers we have to employ. So in the coming weeks, we will launch a major recruitment drive to attract at least 75 new social workers to Wirral to work with our vulnerable children and families. We'll also invest a further £1 million on increasing the number of staff dedicated to safeguarding vulnerable children. The number of children receiving our care, as I said, has massively increased. These increased numbers bring with them, in turn, significantly increased costs, and a sizable portion of this new investment will be used to cover the cost of placements. We'll also invest in improving our early health and early intervention services, help to work with families to identify and tackle problems earlier, reducing the need for children to come into care in the first place, and helping bringing our costs down over the medium long term. We've said it before, and I think it remains true, keeping children safe, making sure they can benefit from the best, most effective services possible, is our number one priority. So, let me say a little bit now about delivering our pledges and the budgetary implications that flow from that. So regardless of the scale of government cuts to this council's budget, which I've outlined, and the services our residents rely on, we will, as an administration, as I say, set a legal and sustainable budget, but with social justice and fairness, Labour values at its heart. Everything we do is aimed at delivering the ambitions laid out in our rural plan, unanimously endorsed by this council in 2015, As I said, we are almost 3 years into this five-year plan. I believe we're making good progress against the 20 pledges that spell out in three broad themes how we'll improve health, the health, wealth and quality of life of our residents. So those three themes. First is keeping vulnerable people safe and protected and tackling inequality. I believe it's absolutely right that this never moves from the top of our agenda, that even in the times as we face of a huge financial challenge and with no support whatsoever from central government, we need to find resources to provide the best possible for services for our most vulnerable children and our most vulnerable residents. Moving on to the second theme, Wirral as a place where employers want to invest and businesses thrive. We're doing all we can to help the economy flourish, ensure local people have good, well-paid jobs. And this is not just about here and now, this is about bringing in new investment that will help our children and our grandchildren. And I believe we are having good success in this area with exciting new projects which will transform our economy in the future. The Wirral Growth Company will help us go further, and we will be making a number of announcements around major progress on this initiative in the early part of 2018. And then the third thing about having an attractive and sustainable environment where good health and an excellent quality of life can be enjoyed by everyone who lives in Wirral. We must ensure that Wirral continues to be a safe, pleasant and attractive place to live and visit. I was delighted this year that we've been able to deliver some major transport infrastructure improvements with my cabinet member, Councillor Whittingham, played a major part in that, as well as finding the resources to make sure our streetlights are fixed and roll out energy-saving LED lighting even further. And rural residents demand and deserve to live in good quality, safe and attractive housing. We cannot tolerate rural residents being forced to live, and we will not tolerate people being forced to live in poor conditions by irresponsible landlords. That's why I was delighted that we were recently able to announce an extension of the successful selective licensing scheme to other areas in the borough. I look forward to that being rolled out further. So without exception, across our 20 pledges, I think we are delivering real results and outcomes. And I'm excited about the progress we've made so far and immensely grateful to voluntary groups, public sector partners, community organisations, and crucially, all our staff. And I want to, at this time of the year, say a big thank you to all our staff, because without them, we wouldn't be able to deliver anything. So I want to make that that point. Who are working, all of which are working together to deliver these outcomes and our 20 pledges. So, moving now on to the measures that I'm going to just briefly go through this morning. So as I say, a balanced budget is the balanced and sustainable budget is the key objective going forward. For 2018-19, we'll use a combination of previously agreed savings, long-term transformation programmes, one-off funding, and the implementation of the council tax precepts created by government in order to bridge the majority of our funding shortfall for the coming year. We do this in the knowledge that our long-term plans through integration of services, redesign and remodelling of what we do, and our income generation strategies will help us deliver financial benefits to support our services in the future. However, given the scale of the challenge that I outlined earlier, some immediate savings and some immediate measures to bring in more income will be required to be made. Our approach to starting the process of balancing our budget, I'll just briefly describe in a second, but we will not implement short-sighted cuts to key services just simply to balance the books. I think it is important to be clear, only Labour will find the more innovative and imaginative ways to raise income, explore new ways to deliver the promises we've made to our residents, and we will be pragmatic and responsible in how we meet budget demands that are being made on. So the proposals that I'm just going to go through, want to make it clear, they don't achieve our full challenge in terms of closing the £61 million gap, but they represent a major progress towards creating a planned, sustainable and fair budget for rural residents. Further work is underway to ensure the budget will be fully balanced by the time we announce our budget next February. A detailed budget which takes account of some key pieces of information we still don't have, so the local government financial settlement. I am told that's due out any day now, but obviously the various levies and precepts which are still to be announced. All of these pieces of information we need to obtain before we can put the final our final budget to Budget Cabinet on the 19th of February next year. So I just want to take you through the measures we're going to be announcing this morning. And there is in the resolution I'm moving, copies of which I'll give out, a table which lists these measures which people can read to get more detail. But I believe the vast majority of the measures identified in the resolution will have little or no impact on the quality, availability or scale of council services our residents rely on. We've always been clear that the broader shoulders should bear the greatest burden, which is why I believe that it's right that the first proposal listed in the measures we're announcing this morning is a significant reduction in our senior management costs. We're also continuing to see financial and environmental benefits from our zero tolerance approach to environmental crime. So an extra £50,000 from this work next year will be achievable and supported by our residents. This does not bring any reduction in service, but it involves greater enforcement of environmental crimes, making those in our community who don't respect the rules contribute to the costs. Again, there is scope to further increase our income through increasing the number of people signing up to the Garden Waste Collection Service. By increasing the promotion and targeting in certain areas, we believe we can attract another 7,500 customers to increase the income by £300,000. We'll do this through partnering with garden centres, home improvement centres to improve the product and targeting promotion in those areas where fewer residents have signed up to the service. Finally, rather than closing public conveniences, we propose to introduce a small charge, around 30p, to part fund their maintenance and upkeep. Nowadays, this is a fairly standard practice across the UK and a move we believe people will understand and accept. Moving on, we can also get a better deal, I believe, on some of the contracts we commission. For example, recommissioning our contracts for assisted travel can generate better economies of scale without impacting on people receiving the service. We can also generate some savings by changing the contract we have in place for parking enforcement. Again, this will have no impact on residents nor on the service we provide. It just delivers better value on work which we commission. We'll also be consulting with residents on introducing car parking charges at certain coastal visitor locations. In New Brighton, this does not include Marine Point and Fort Perch Rock, but does include Derby Pool and King's Parade. It also includes Liso Lighthouse and the Gun Sight, North Parade between Hoylake and Mells, and South Parade and West Kirby. The proposed charges would be £1 for an hour, £2 for all day, and £20 for overnight parking. I believe these tariffs are reasonable and acceptable for visitors to our coastal attractions and will not impact on the popularity of these locations. We'll work extensively with residents and local groups who use these sites on a regular basis. We also hope it will reduce the number of cars left for extended periods of time blocking available parking at these sites. As I mentioned, we'll increase income through our selective licensing scheme, which helps to massively increase the quality of private rented housing available for residents. The schemes have been successful in the pilot locations on our aim of making landlords more accountable and responsible for the properties they manage and let. We're also looking to be more commercial. Some of our communications engagement services that we offer will provide graphic design and other services to public sector partners and private sector organisations as a means to generate income while at the same time reducing our staff costs. And as well as finding new ways to generate income, to change services and make what we deliver better for residents, it's important we're as efficient as possible with how we manage ourselves. We've been able to generate savings of more than £4 million in the way we work, which I believe is a huge achievement. This includes changing our approach to minimum revenue provision, which will help us deliver 3.8 million in savings. And we're also modernising how we do business. For example, we can make a modest but important saving of 34,000 by removing paper agendas for meetings and replacing them with more modern IT kit. There is a benefit also, obviously, for our recycling and environmental targets in there too. So, moving to the conclusion. We will never set a budget in isolation. Consultation, engagement and conversations with residents will always underpin the decisions we take. Engagement with residents should be a 365-day-a-year process. We will always listen to what's most important to local people and their views. Will always underpin every decision we make. So Cabinet will ensure rural residents and elected members are able to fully engage and participate in the budget setting process. And to ensure this happens, we'll instruct officers to develop a budget consultation programme and scrutiny review process to run throughout January 2018 in advance of the formal budget setting process in February and March of next year. So in conclusion, I believe we've made much progress in developing a balanced and sustainable budget for 2018-19. We've got more work to do, as I mentioned. Developing a legal budget which minimises the impact on services and doesn't hinder us from delivering our pledges is a huge challenge. And as I say, faced with a budget gap of 61 million, the biggest we've ever faced, we believe the proposals that I've mentioned this morning are a responsible mix of savings, working smarter and increasing income generation. Clearly, we'll continue to work during the coming weeks and months and make sure that this budget, when it finally comes before we debate it by full council in March, is sustainable, fair, and underpins everything we stand for as a Labour administration. So, in conclusion, turning to the recommendations. Cabinet are requested to, and I'll just go through them, accept all the recommendations contained within the medium term financial strategy and council budget 2018 report at item 6 of the agenda today. And just to spell out what they are, first one is to note the recent developments regarding the forecast budget gap and the progress towards implementing the medium term financial strategy, including the pressures for 2018-19. Secondly, note the projected budget gap for 2018-19 and the requirement to develop further budget reductions and financial proposals. Thirdly, note the projected funding gap for the period 2019-20 to 2020-21 and the requirement to develop the current budget process to deliver the required budget reductions. And fourthly, an updated budget report and medium-term financial strategy to be presented to Cabinet on the 19th of February next year, and this will cover the updated financial projections, including further budget reductions and financial proposals for 2018-19, and details of the impact of announcements such as the local government financial settlement. And cabinets are being requested to agree a further two recommendations in respect to the council budget for 2018-19. And these are as follows. Firstly, we agree the proposals are just set out in this resolution and instruct officers to develop an appropriate consultation programme to allow rural residents to input to the budget setting process. And then secondly, develop a programme throughout January 2018 whereby elected members from all parties can, through the scrutiny committee system, review the budget proposals and provide their views to the cabinet. So, colleagues, that is the budget resolution. I apologise for taking so long to take you through that, but I think it's important given the gravity of the situation that I read out the detail of what we're proposing. So, I think Shirley can give out copies of the resolution, and I'll take any comments and contributions from cabinet members. Thank you. Jeanette.
Thanks for that, Phil. Yeah, I mean, I just want to, underline the fact that we do have a legal obligation to set balanced budgets. Our residents expect it from us, and actually the Labour League also expects it from us, and that's what we've done here, through a lot of hard work. I'm going to say as well that none of us sitting at least around this table here came into politics to have to make decisions like this. It's the last thing I ever wanted to do, but I think what we've managed to do is put forward a set of proposals that don't actually impact on frontline services. But what I do need to stress is that income generation is a very big part of this. We don't want to impact on frontline services. We have to grow income stream to come in this account. Once our revenue support grant is gone, we are on our own, as you said, Phil. And I'd just like to say that despite the shameless plaint of the gallery last week of the Conservative leader, it was absolutely shameless the way he played to the public gallery, given that it's his government that has done this to us. I mean, I was almost like living in a parallel universe that night when I had to sit through what he was saying. But we do know where the blame lies. We know where fair and squarely lies, and that's at this government's door. So I just want to commend the work that's been done by officers and members to get these budget proposals together. It's been a really, really hard task. It's been done well, but we haven't hit any of the frontline services.
Okay. Bernie.
I hope everybody can hear me. There is absolutely no way that we can explain the crisis that we have in children's services, not just in this council, but the 75% of the councils in this country. The young people we're looking at after are the most vulnerable people in society, and we have to find the money to look after these children. And absolutely, every day I stand and I look at the work that our staff are doing to turn this around. Our staff are absolutely amazing in some of the work that we do. So are our young people. Our young people are amazing. And we need to find the money to sort of bring this forward. Phil's rightly said austerity is at the base of the problems that are being caused. And I don't think there's anything that explains how bad the situation is than the resignation of the Social Mobility Committee, a national committee, where the whole committee, which is cross-party, Tories, Lib Dems and Labour, felt that they had absolutely no option but to stand down because there was no tools that they could improve social mobility in this country. That is an indictment on what's happening. This Tory government are so obsessed with Brexit, the rest of the country's falling to bits and they don't seem to care. But I commend what we're doing, finding the money for children's services. We are working hard to improve where we are. Things are getting better, but we are having more children to look after, and as long as austerity goes on, we will have to look after more children. It's on the national news today, so anybody who turns their television on today will see that Bernard's saying that they've 50%, 100% more children are coming into care because of exploitation of one source or another. So the situation gets worse by the day, and we're doing our very best. But this government didn't even have one word to acknowledge that in their budget, which is an absolute disgrace. But I think the resignation of the Social Mobility Committee has got to just look everybody in the face and say, there's nothing we can do. Until this government starts giving us some support, what can we do? But we're not like that government. We're all doing the very, very best they can to make sure that our kids are protected and looked after. And I am delighted that we've made this in the budget. I think it should be commended and supported 100%. Thanks.
Thank you, and I've echoed what my colleagues have said. I think your speech is really powerful, Phil, and I think setting out the issues that we have is really important. It's an eye-watering amount, isn't it, £61 million, when we've already taken out so much money from our budgets. And it's the absolute sort of Tory austerity dream to try and strangle, I don't think they can strangle an economy back to life, but I think what they're trying to do is reduce the size of the state, reduce the size of support to people. And the difficulty is, as charities lose funding, as various sort of commissions and projects lose funding, the responsibility falls to this council. And we won't let them down, we'll do everything we can, but at the same time, our own resources are dwindling. We've got to build houses. There is a housing crisis in this country, and that falls upon this council to build those houses, yet we have less money. There are increasing number of children to protect each and every year, partly due to the austerity policies that are plunging families into crisis and difficulties. And it falls upon this council, but we have less money. And you think of the health and social care crisis, you think of the issues we have where we want to protect and support our parks, our roads, everything, the infrastructure of rural. Everything falls to this council,
And we are doing everything possible, working with partners to try and leverage everything to try and deal with these crises. But at the end of the day, this is a question for the government of this country. They need to fund. They need to fund councils across the country better, especially rural. I think it's really important to note that all we can do, we will relentlessly campaign for a Labour government that will fix this. But whilst we're here, under a Tory government, we've got to find ways of bringing money into this council. I think it's incredible that we have managed to stave off closures of so many services, unlike our councils across the country. But actually, we've got to find ways of bringing income in, because unless we do that, unless we get more money into this council, there is no way we're going to fund those services. Those children that are plunged into crisis get plunged into further crisis, and I think it's our responsibility to continue to work tirelessly to find every extra penny we can to help people. So thank you for your motion, I think you support it.
Any other comments? Anybody wishes to say? George?
I think it's important that we do. First of all, I congratulate the leader on the speech that she's given out. But I think people need to understand it across the world, the actual problems that are facing the people of the world and the future of the people of the world. And people who have lived here all their lives, like my good self and everybody else around this table, are absolutely certain that what we're going to try and do is make sure that we do have a life after 2021. And one of the things that I was just going to understand, my role is in terms of housing and community safety. And one of the things that I don't think a lot of people in this borough understand is the amount of value that are placed on council tax bands A, B. So if I just give you a very quick example, which is in your document for this morning, for a 60,000 in band A, 32,000 in band B, 27,000 in band C. It then drops off completely in band D to 13,000, 8,000 in E, 4,000 in F, 3,120 in G, and most importantly in band H, 262 properties right across the whole of Wirral. Now I've got to make you understand, I hope I can make you understand, that is based on the average of band D across the country. So we are 80% on A, B and C are covered in those things which are under the average. So therefore it's a major headache for the people of Wirral to be able to do things any different. So there is a massive shortage of the top nine houses, and we've also got to support the lower band houses where there is affordable housing required across the board. So I just want to make it absolutely abundantly clear that you need to always concentrate that focus on what is band A. That's what the government pay you in council tax. So we don't get, we're actually 80% under that band when we get our money. So we need to really, really understand that position. Thank you, Phil.
George, just to add to that, I mean, that's why the current local government funding system is so unfair to northern authorities like rural, because a 1% council tax increase, because of those figures you just quoted, 80% of properties in band A, B and C, a 1% council tax increase raises nowhere near as much as a 1% council tax increase in Westminster.
Correct.
With absolutely multi-million pound houses in bands H. And that's the fundamental unfairness that we've been calling to be addressed for years and years and years now.
At least 15 years.
The government doesn't seem to or don't want to recognise that. And that is a fundamental unfairness in the system. I think we just need to, people need to be aware of that.